Hi, I'm Sudhakar Vichali, X-Series Mentor. I'm a travel and wedding photographer based out of Hyderabad.
Hi, I'm Saurabh Chatterjee. I'm a travel photographer.
So today we are here to talk about how we switched from a different ecosystem to Fuji. And we are not here to talk about this system is bad and this system is good. It's all about from a usability standpoint. So I switched over from Canon. Saurabh, so you switched very recently, let's say 6 to 8 months back.
Yeah.
So how did that switch happen and what made you to hold another camera? Because you were already married to Nikon by that time.
Yes. So the biggest challenge was now it was getting more and more difficult to travel with so much gear that I had. So I wanted something light. So I was exploring what are the different options that are there in the market, and Fuji was one, definitely one good option. So I was a little skeptical because it's a crop sensor, and then I was carrying full frame sensors. But then when I compared the dynamic range or the details that I'm getting with the Fuji cameras, they are absolutely at par with any other full frame camera. Well, I was convinced when I compared the image quality, I was very convinced that, okay, Fuji is giving very good colors and very good details. But then when I was seeing other people, my clients, they were sometimes very skeptical about this thing. So I recently went to shoot in a farm in Orissa, and I was having my XH1, and the client knew, he was a good friend, so he knew what I was doing. But then there was another guy who was looking a little skeptical and asked me, are you going to use this camera to shoot this? So it was very funny. I said, you don't worry, you leave it up to me, and then I'll do my job well.
Yeah, I take that to an advantage because you know how we shoot, especially travel, when you go to palaces and UNESCO sites where, you know, people will not allow you a big white lens and things. I recently happened to visit Chaumala, and you know, they don't allow it. You can just walk in and nobody will actually, you know, stop you to shoot because they think you're not a professional photographer.
Right.
So we are basically here to shoot. So we don't want to know people to know that we are here to shoot and we want to grab attention. These things will make your job more easier.
Absolutely.
From a travel perspective.
Right.
And from my wedding perspective, what I would say is I will reach to the places where I couldn't earlier. Like with big system with a 70-200 lens, I can't just reach to some place and take the shot from the angle that I wanted to. Now I can reach to the place and I can just put it and I can still operate it with my phone. So that's the advantage that I see.
Definitely.
And I don't see an image quality perspective that it has gone down, because I don't see any difference, because we are not here to print the billboard sizes.
One thing that really changed, because when I travel, I shoot a lot of people, and when I'm shooting people, if you have a big lens and a bigger camera, then it builds a barrier between you and your subject. And when I'm using these tiny lenses, people, you see that barrier is kind of gone because it's a really small camera and I'm interacting with my subjects a lot. So that has really changed the way I take pictures of people, at least.
The 3 points that you really liked when you moved from a conventional DSLR to mirrorless or Fuji systems.
First thing is definitely the weight. I can't give more importance to this. It has totally changed the way I photograph, because now my bag is much smaller and less weight on my shoulders and less backache. So, I mean, absolutely, I can walk more and I can travel more and I can definitely take more pictures eventually. So that is definitely my first point I'm going to.
Yeah, absolutely. For me also, because shooting a wedding for a day long is always a tedious job, because you cannot carry, you know, 4 or 5 kgs of weight on your shoulder from day till night. And that has changed, because weight is the first issue that I actually tend to lean towards the mirrorless or Fuji systems. And weight and size, obviously, because the lens size also has gone down with the coming from a full frame to Fuji systems. So eventually weight is there. For me, the other factor that I could think of is like any consumer, it's the price point. I was shooting with Canon 5D, which was about 2 lakhs that point of time. Now I've got an X-T1. The first camera that I switched was X-T1, which I got it from US for about, you know, $1,000, which is like 70,000, which is half the price of my full frame.
Even my X-H1 is somewhere around 80K.
80K.
It's very much affordable and at par with any full frame DSLR.
Apart from that, yes, I agree, the image quality is on par with what we are shooting and how much we consume. The first thing I fell in love with the dials, because all the control dials are on,
right,
top. Like I don't have to really chimp in, see the image, or you know, check the settings and move on. No, I don't do that now. I just keep it like this, and then I know my shutter button is here, I know my ISO is here, I know my aperture is here. So I hardly go into the menu systems. So that was the break point where I thought this is going to make my life more easier.
I'm shooting with an XH1, which has an amazing image stabilization. Especially, I started shooting a lot of videos, and it really helps me a lot. So, super smooth video, very well stabilized, and I don't need or I don't carry a gimbal all the time because my kind of shooting, I travel to places and I want to travel as light as possible. So it helps me take very, very stable videos as well.
As a travel photographer too, I always carried two systems. One for my photos and one for my videos. Now I don't have to do this because XH1 has an amazing image stabilization, like you said. So my almost 2 kgs has cut down. I mean, 2 bodies to 1 body. I can do both because it's a hybrid. I can shoot and immediately switch from, you know, photo to video. Now I go to a location, want to shoot, I actually put it like this and video mode, and then I try to, you know, pan, zoom, do everything, then get my frames right. It actually made my job easier. So that's an amazing point, that it has cut down the weight, and also, you know, 2 systems, 2 lenses, or, you know, we have the gas system of, you know, gear acquisition, art lens, this lens. So it has cut down everything.
I really like the build quality. So when I hold the camera in my hands, when I hold the X-T3, I feel like I'm holding something, and I feel like shooting when I use that camera. So that is one thing. So I think that's a basic necessity of any camera. When you should feel good in your hands even before you start shooting. I think the XH1 definitely gives me this this feeling, so that I go and shoot more. And
so that your decision was right to move from a, you know, conventional DSLR to mirrorless. In the Fuji system that I've observed is, from my X-T1, I've changed only 2-3 systems, X-T1, XH1 and my X-T3. Okay, and I've seen Fuji giving a lot of firmware upgrades to even X-T1 right now. I mean, currently I've got, probably 3 months back, I have an upgrade from firmware. This never happened in any of the cameras that I use. I buy a Canon 5D Mark II, then I have to switch over to 5D Mark III to upgrade myself. Now here, that's not the case. And I'm happy about it, because at least, you know, one company or some company thinks about, okay, from a, you know, photographer's perspective. For example, X-T2 never had a 4K video in their initial launch, but with the firmware upgrade, they've given you a 4K capability shooting, and that's amazing, because otherwise if you have to buy a 4K camera, you'll have to again invest another couple of lakhs, that you don't have to really upgrade your gear now and then. You can still carry on at least for, you know, a few years, because like I'm carrying my X-T1 even after 4 years or 5 years, and I'm happy about it.
I somehow like the colors of the XH1 really a lot.
The whole world says the Fuji colors are amazing.
I don't know what is it about, but there is something about it which I can't explain.
How about electronic viewfinder? So do you have some?
Yeah, the electronic viewfinder is another one thing. It is quite big and bright, and I can see things much more clearly. So that is another thing. So I can really see whether the pictures are in focus or not. So yeah, that really helps. My 2 basic lenses would be a 24-70 and a 70-200, and a super wide, something like 12-10-15-30, something like that. So but now maybe even my style is changing, so I'm with my XH1, I'm just using the 18-55 lens, and I'm very happy with it, and that has made my photography much simpler, and I'm still able to do what I want to do. So I think I'm not missing my telephoto or my super wide lenses.
When I started with only 2 lenses, like you said, one the basic lens and one the prime lens, because I shoot weddings and portraits. Then eventually I moved to third lens, and I stopped. For 3 years, I've never bought a lens. 3 lenses, and all my job was done. So imagine from 7-8 lenses, from 2 bodies and huge tripod, from, let's say, from a price standpoint, 6-7 lakhs, it has become 3 lakhs. From a weight perspective, it has, you know, from, let's say, 6 kgs to it's become 2 kgs. So imagine how the life has been changed.
I'm not a big fan of Wi-Fi. I never used to be, because I never would post pictures immediately. I mean, a lot of people do that, take pictures and immediately share it on Facebook. I generally don't do that. But one feature I really like is the camera connects to the mobile phone and takes the GPS coordinates. So every picture with the exit data, you also get the GPS coordinate, which is a really good thing to have. It also syncs the time as well. So if there's something right, and especially when you're traveling across time zones, when you're traveling across countries and it's a hassle to go to the settings and change the time again and again. So now this is one very good feature. So the moment it connects to your mobile phone, it takes the time, the local time, and then the GPS coordinates. It's a very helpful feature for a travel photographer.
And as a wedding photographer, it helps me a lot because you know how wedding goes. You know there are a lot of people walking in, and they say, "Can you take a picture of mine?" And then eventually they tend to forget because we can't really transfer them. I remember because I was shooting with Canon, and I would say, "Okay, give us a call later. We will give you." And then it never happens. Now with this system, I just immediately transfer because my system is always connected to my phone, and I do a couple of clicks, and then I have the image in my phone and I share it with them and they're happy about it.
That is one. I do a lot of time lapses, and this feature is really good. So I think Fuji time lapse is the simplest I've ever seen. It's a very, very simple, no nonsense thing. It hardly takes seconds to set it up, and then it just goes on and on. So it's really very, very helpful.
I know. It does have amazing time lapse factor because I am a big fan of making time lapses, and it's amazing. I hope they also include the video factor in it. Hope Fujifilm listens to it and then give us an upgrade. But otherwise, these are smaller things that makes my jobs easier, my life easier. In fact, what is the maximum ISO you ever used? Because I know you shoot astro photography and I shoot as well, but we just want to put it across on the table. What is the highest ISO you used ever to bring out a photograph?
Well, I have used really crazy ISO, and I don't mind going at higher ISOs. But because of the image stabilization, when I'm shooting handheld, I can also go for a slow shutter speed. So now with Fuji, I have tried half a second and it works very well. So because of the stabilization in the body and stabilization in the lens, it really makes a lot of difference. So now when I'm shooting with my hands, I try to go as slow as possible, and so that brings down the ISO. So that is one thing which I'm doing a lot nowadays.
What is the maximum that you used to take a Milky Way photograph?
I've never used more than 5,000 ever. So never ever. So generally it is the maximum I use is 4,000.
4,000.
Yeah.
And people still have the notion that I need to have a 1,28,000 ISO. So we wanted to call out this point, especially because we get a lot of inquiries on how is ISO, how is the low light performance. Okay, so we never go beyond, let's say, 5,000, 6,000, even to shoot photographs of a Milky Way. A lot of color profiles, especially for video making, Eterna, cinema look and F-log, these things a consumer level photographer would never understand earlier because we were like blank. Okay, now systems are evolving and we're going ahead. So I see, I don't have to do a post production, or if I'm a person who's want to do a video shoot and don't have post production capability, I can go ahead and just simply switch on to my Eterna film mode, or there are a lot of color profiles, right? I can switch it on and then make it look like more cinematic.
I've not done much color grading in my videos in post production. So in fact, I've delivered some projects straight out of the camera without much color grading, and it turns out to be quite well actually. So, and very professional quality.
Do you ever feel that is there any difference between a conventional DSLR focus system and this? Is it faster? Is it better?
Now with the latest firmware upgrades, we have this eye focus and face recognition, which works pretty well. So, and it makes our job very easy when I'm shooting. So I don't have to really pay a lot of attention to focusing. The camera does it really well, so recognizing the face and the eye does very well.
Most of the time I use autofocus. I mostly switch into manual only when I turn into video. Now that has also been upgraded because it has continuous focus system with just one click, and then it nicely do the depth of field shift,
right?
And you can also, I'm sure you must have seen in XH1, there's a focus shift speed, so you can actually define the focus speed,
right?
How fast you want, or
right,
how slow you want to turn your shift. And that's amazing. I've not seen, because if you're shooting a wildlife, you can actually put it on a high speed and then it will turn. And if you're shooting some, you know, subjects with a, you know, stationary, you can always have that, you know, slow and then make it feel more cinematic. I have not seen any other camera. I was very fancy about it when I actually saw it in XH1.
So, I'm not having a backache, which I used to have very regularly when I was carrying my two full frame body and a couple of lenses. So. And I can travel more and I can travel lighter and I can take more pictures because I get less tired. So especially when I'm traveling and taking pictures. So yes, it has, even when I'm taking pictures of people, it has cut down the barrier because now I'm using smaller body and smaller lenses. So it definitely had made a lot of difference. The only thing I'm concerned a little about is battery, and that's common for all mirrors.
All mirrors,
they
yes.
obviously consume a lot more power because it is an electronic viewfinder and because of the mechanism. So the only solution is to carry more batteries, which is okay.
I think that's fine because it comes with the mirrorless systems.
Yeah.
That's for now. And we will sign off from here. But however, you can find Saurabh Chatterjee links below in the description. And we will have the X-Pro 3 coming up very soon. And we will post you and keep you updated. Keep watching, keep shooting. Thank you.
Thank you.